Hello, my name is Wade Price, and I can be set up within 9 inches of the enemy. And today, I sat down with Darren Latham to talk to him about his time as an heavy metal painter, a golden demon judge, and now a miniatures designer responsible for working on loads of 40k Citadel miniatures. Hey, Daz.
How's it going?
It's very good, thank you. Thank you very much for spending some time with us today.
My pleasure.
So I'm joined by Citadel miniatures designer, ex-heavy metal painter, ex-golden demon judge, Darren Latham.
That's brilliant. It's nice to be here, Wade. Thanks.
You're very, very welcome. So how did you get into Games Workshop? I guess let's go back right back to the mists of time. How did you get into Games Workshop on Warhammer?
So I still remember I was at home. My brother was at high school, and I was nearly at high school, and he came home from high school, and he had a magazine with him. And I was like, probably guess what magazine that was. It was White Dwarf magazine. And I still remember which one it was. It was one with the Eldar on the cover, the LA Tuck Eldar, and they were all coming across the battlefield. And I was like, just had a look at it, and I was blown away. I was like, this is for me. This is what I want. And I had a look on the back, and it had Blood Angels and Eldar fighting. And I was instantly just, I knew this is what I wanted to do. So he got Hero Quest for Christmas, and played some. I had to beg him to let me paint one of them, so I painted one of the goblins from Hero Quest.
Didn't even trust you with an adventurer. I trusted you with
no,
a goblin.
No, it was one of the goblins. So I did one of those, and we used my dad's enamel paints because he used to paint ships and model ships and things. So maybe that's where I get some of it from. We used his enamel paints and his brushes, and completely wrecked them and painted our Hero Quest set. Played loads of Hero Quest, and then. I asked for some miniatures as well for Christmas, so we got some miniatures. And then it was Space Crusade after that. And, you know, I think a lot of people have the same story.
Yep.
Getting into the hobby, you know, hobbyists around my age as well. I always say Hero Quest, Space Crusade. Then it was Warhammer Quest. And it escalated, and you played, you know, like you played with your armies and you played battles. Yeah. And it was great. And then there was a little group of us at school, and we'd hire out a scout hut, and we'd play massive game over the weekend with all our miniatures, and then we'd camp over there, and we'd play the game all night, and then go back, and it was just awesome. There was a whole group of us, and that was sort of my entry into this whole amazing hobby. So but it was always the painting side of things which I was sort of warmed towards a little bit more. I think it was because two reasons. I've always been a bit creative anyway. I always really liked art and drawing, but I never really had many miniatures, so I had to spend a long time painting the ones I had. So
okay.
It was Christmas. My brother would probably have, he'd ask for sensible stuff, like, I want this unit and this character and this war machine for my army. And I was like, I want all these characters. And that was all I had, was just loads and loads of characters. So I just painted all the Chaos characters and all the Space Marine characters, and the ones I really liked, and just cherry picked them and practiced on those. So I never really had full armies when I was younger, although I joined in, but it was all just painted characters and just practiced
single
on
miniatures.
Those. Yeah, and I knew they had to last me until my birthday and until next Christmas. So I just painted them and then maybe repainted over some bits and then maybe swapped one or two, you know, like people do. But yeah, that was where I really started with Games Workshop, and then dropped out for a little bit when I went to college.
It happens.
And then got back into it as well. I just got Drew straight back in. So that was there you go, that's the story. So it's my brother's fault. Dave got me into it, and Dave and I still play games now.
Cool.
He recently, a few years ago, really got back into the hobby big time. I think mainly with the new 40k. He loves that, and he's got a Blood Angel army and he's got a Death Guard army, and we play games all the time now, like once a month I think we try and play a game. So it's nice that it's sort of still happening. Like, you know, we're around sort of 40 and we're still playing games, like, you know, like we used to do, and it's just really cool.
Living the dream.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, just for a few hours you just forget about everything else and just get your miniatures out, roll some dice, scream at each other. Yeah, we had a game the other day as well. It was amazing. So he uses Blood Angels and I was using my Eldar, and he was like, I've got to beat you today. And I was like, okay, cool. And he'd not beaten me yet with his Blood Angels. So that day he did. He took me down big time because he'd been practicing at the club with all these other people, which I didn't know about. And he came back and was like, I'm going to use this stratagem. I'm going to do this and this. And I was like, what's going on? And he totally beat me. And yeah.
So you didn't just let him beat you?
No. I tried. But that was really fun. So yeah, I like playing games as well. So
Whereabouts was this where you were growing up? Was there a Games Workshop store around there, or was this a toy store or hobby store?
No, so hometown is Tamworth, so there was no Games Workshop there because it's a small town. So there was just a group of us that were at school, and we just we played there. And then from Tamworth, I moved from Tamworth to go to university in Leicester, and then that was when I was really introduced to Games Workshop, the store, because they have the store there. And then I started working there part time whilst I was at university. So that was my first sort of experience with Games Workshop and Games Workshop stores. So before that, it was all learning to paint at home, playing the games outside of all of that, and just a little group of us. So.
And how quickly did the store staff identify your ability to paint single miniatures really nicely?
I had my stuff in the cabinet straight away. It was like, well, I think went in and spoke to the manager as on the day I started university. I was like, right, where's Games Workshop? Mm-hmm. Who cares about everything else? Went in there and showed him some of my miniatures, and he's like, oh, they've got to go in the cabinet. So we had them in the cabinet, and then quickly it was, have you got any part-time jobs? Mm-hmm. You know, I worked as a key timer for a bit.
Get and then, discount.
Well, there was that. But I was just blown away by the atmosphere in the store. And it was just so cool just to be around like-minded people and just playing games and, you know, painting more miniatures. And it was just really great. And worked there with Simon, who was one of my old school friends, and he was the full timer there as well. So it was really nice to sort of be there with him as well. Yeah. And he sort of helped me through through the first few weeks and helped me integrate into retail, which is an experience in itself.
Absolutely,
and
he
used to work in retail as well, so you know.
At uni as well,
Whilst he was at uni, So I mean, I did. So when I did that, I was just, I had to be working for Games Workshop because I just loved it so much. So then I joined Games Workshop full time and worked in retail full time for 2 years and moved through some different stores. Mm. So, and that job was crazy. So it's really, really difficult job, and I respect anybody that did any retail work, especially in Games Workshop, because it's really challenging as well, but it's really fun, especially if you're working with great people, which you always do. And you know, running big games on a Sunday or a Saturday takes a lot of energy, and
it does,
you know, I don't think I could do it now. I haven't got like that sort of energy in me.
Nope, no, not me.
But the guys that work in retail, they do an amazing job, and I still pop through to the store now just to say hi and just soak up the atmosphere. And it's good because working in retail, did 2 years, worked in a few different stores, like I said, but it's a great experience just to be around our customers and talk to our customers. And obviously, I'm a customer too, so it's just never really felt like work. We were just playing games all day, and yeah, it was good. It was a laugh.
I know a lot of people from head office who make a point of leaving at the end of the day, walking through the gaming hall in Warhammer World, just to kind of check in and take stock and remember all of this is possible. Like, we have these great jobs that we love doing, possible because of the hobbyists and the community that are really enthused by all of this stuff, and this is why we're out there doing it.
Absolutely. I mean, we work at head office, so sometimes you can forget that there is the store there and what's going on out there on the front lines in the store. So and the guys in Warhammer World do a great job. Actually, my last retail position was in Warhammer World with Mark Chambers. So we was in the Leicester store, and he said, I'm going to go to Warhammer World and we're going to change Warhammer World. I was like, that sounds awesome. Cool. Do you want to come? I was like, yeah. so we were. He came over here to Nottingham. And I was like, well, okay, so I'll move as well. Got nothing better to do. So we took Warhammer World from where it was. It was actually a completely different museum. And it was just a basketball, couple of basketball courts. There was no real gaming area or real museum. It was an old museum. And we basically, well, we'll say we. Mark really did all the hard work. And I was working in the store with Prince, who was the manager at the time as well. So. And that was really good fun. That was a hard job as well. And then obviously, once I'm at head office, I get to see all the cool head office stuff. And then I was like, I think the studio looks cool. So then it was, you know, seeing what the heavy metal guys, because in the museum we had the heavy metal miniatures, and that was something that I'd always pored over in the magazines. Yeah. It was like the Holy Grail. So, and I could see those miniatures, you know, in the cabinet. So that was when really started sort of looking at that as a serious sort of thing for me. So,
how did you go about getting into the heavy metal team then?
So Chris Smart was the heavy metal supervisor at the time, really cool guy, and he used to come down to the store and he saw my stuff in the cabinets. So, and he said, do you fancy doing some stuff for White Dwarf? And I was like, yeah. He was like, I'm not going to pay you for it. I was like, I don't
care. Exposure. Pay you an exposure.
I said, it's fine. What do you want? And he goes, well, I need this. It was a Saurus on a cold one. It was a conversion that he wanted me to do. And I said, okay, I can do that. No problem. And I said, and he said, I need it in 2 days. And I said, yeah, no problem. Because I was 20.
Impetuousness of you.
I don't need sleep.
No.
I just need to paint. So yeah. So I did that. And he was really happy with that. And then he gave me a few more bits. And then I got a phone call. I was working in the store. And he said, there's a position I want you to apply for. And I was like, I'm going to do that. So applied for the position and got the job. And yeah. Working heavy metal, it was crazy. Mm. It was in the studio,
living the dream.
Heavy metal, it was really, really cool. And still thinking about it now, it's just I've got the badge still. Heavy metal painter, everybody, any heavy metal painter gets a badge, and you only get it if you're part of that team. So I've still got it on my shelf. It's just a nice reminder. So,
is that with all the Golden Demon winners awards as well?
Not too many Golden Demon awards.
Okay.
By the time I felt that I'd got good enough to enter Golden Demon, I was full time in heavy metal, and then taking part in the Golden Demon competition as judging as well. So there was many years where I sort of, I guess it sounds like a bit of an excuse, but I really sort of couldn't enter because I was doing the judging as well. Plus, so I've got the last few years I've started entering a little bit. Won some open competitions and some of the smaller Golden Demons as well, entered some of those. But yeah, before that it was just painting full time and then getting asked to judge Golden Demon as well, which was a massive, massive honour. But yeah, so
10 years in the heavy metal game? 10 years as an heavy metal painter?
Yeah, 10 years. So seen a lot of painters come and go, but there's still some awesome painters in there. So Neil Green was in the team when I first started, and he was my mentor, I would say, although unofficially. He's the unsung hero of heavy metal. He's still painting in heavy metal now, and I think he's one of the best painters that I've ever met. Still like showing the guys how it's done, but really in a quiet way. You know, he's not in your face about it or anything like that. And so we're going to have a chat with him, really down to earth. So he showed me how to use glazes and washes and all these other nuances and things that you could add to miniatures that I didn't even know. I thought it was just about putting colours on. But he showed me all these different techniques, and that was really great. And then Martin Footit was in the team at the time as well. He's one of the miniature designers as well. Neil Langdown joined the team. He's also a miniature designer. Dave Thomas was in the team. Forgeal, miniature designer. So you can see the trend. So it's a natural progression from figure painting to, you know, because you're holding these miniatures and you've got a love for these miniatures, you paint them, you convert them, some more, then you end up making them. So that's kind of the natural progression there. So yeah, but worked with those are great painters. And towards the end of my heavy metal career, I was the senior figure painter, which was basically means running those projects, making sure that they sort of gel together and the color schemes are harmonious and sort of planned and everything as well. So that was fun, being having a little bit more input into that as well, and working with other people, just getting, because it's not as simple as just painting that model.
No.
You know, there's some more thought into it than that. So that was really cool as well. So
I guess like being a miniatures designer, being able to have that creative input when you have creative ambitions or aspirations, and you've been painting other people's miniatures for a long time, and like you say, when you're looking at them, thinking about them, converting them, thinking about how you would maybe do it differently or how you would tweak things for the benefit of the painter.
Yeah, absolutely. And when you're a studio painter, you get to do your own thing as well. But there's also, when you're painting, you've got to make sure that they fit in with the Games Workshop backgrounds and worlds. So orcs are green, you know, Blood Angels are red. You know, you can't go doing crazy things, but there is an opportunity to do some, you know, you can be creative, but then it's got to all fit in with everything else as well. So, and the other thing you have to realize is a lot of hobbyists will copy what they see on the box art as well. So that's got to be achievable. And one of those color schemes have got to be well thought through. Then we don't just pick them and then they go, yeah, that's fine. You know, they've got to go through a whole process of being approved, and And the guys that are in the FNL team now, they've taken it to a whole other level. They're really, you know, the stuff they're doing now is amazing. And they're really planning their projects. And I thought I used to plan the projects with the team, and now they're doing everything all out. So, and the painting level that they're at now as
It's incredible, isn't it?
It keeps going up and up. And we thought when we were doing it as a team, it was, it's never going to get better than this. You know, come on, guys. And then now it's, I go over and say hello to them, and I'm just like, oh God, I gotta just walk away. And I'm trying to keep up still, but it gets harder and harder because they're doing it every day, and they're pushing it, and they're pushing each other. And yeah, it's just it's a challenge to try and keep up with those guys if you're still a painter. And there's a few of us figure designers that still try and experimental guys that try and do a little bit, but yeah, those guys, they've got it.
Is it a bigger heavy metal team now than it was in your day?
It is bigger, yeah. So they've just had a new guy join, Connor Richardson, young lad. He's just joined the team as well. And yeah, the team is bigger. We're making more miniatures. We've got more miniature designers, so they've got to paint more models. I think, like, look, honestly, the team is, right now, it's the best it's ever been. And that is the way it should be. But I think that's down to the passion and determination from the painters and their outlook on our products as well. They've got a great team. Max Fillet is one of the names that I could say. I mean, he's, when he talks about miniatures, he really, you can tell he cares a lot, and he knows so much about painting as well. Anya's still there, she's still painting. Anya's really cool, does an amazing job. Aiden's doing some awesome stuff as well. There's Tom, Dave Perryman. Natalie's there as well. She's doing some great stuff. They're all amazing, right? And the whole team together, they're just, yeah, they're showing us all how it's done, that's for sure. So
so you must have seen a few different paint ranges in your time. 10 years in heavy metal must have transitioned from a few different ranges of paints, because that was the foundation range of paints 10 years or so, I don't know how many years ago, and then kind of mid teens, 20 teens, there was a new paint range introduced, huge big overhauling of the colours.
Yeah.
How do you keep the finished miniatures looking consistent, or how do you keep everyone on the same page when there are big changes to the paint range like that?
Yeah. Well, with being a part of this year, we get notice of that, so we can adapt with it. But I get in trouble for the amount of paint I've got anyway, so I always still keep buying more paint. And my wife says, you've not got enough paint. I said, you can never have enough paint. Ali Morrison always says to me, no, you're right, you can never have enough paint. He's the same, so he just collects paint. So I've got paints from all of our old ranges, like, because we've got the old Hex Pop paints, and I still like using some of those, because those colours are cool, and I just like it, and it's a bit retro as well.
Some old metallic greens, a bit of glistening green or something.
Yeah, all of that, bit of ruby red. Ben Jefferson and I always, oh, you've got a nice bit of ruby red, you've got some of that. And then, like, as the paints go through, they evolve and they get better. And the paint range we've got now was the paint, something that I worked on just before I left heavy metal with Dave Cross, which was a real privilege, was to design with him the new paint range and the new Citadel colour system, introducing the new dry brush paints and shades and layers. And so that it was about you being able to get your army or your miniatures on the tabletop easier, quicker, so that you can enjoy playing games with them. That was the whole, you know, the purpose of doing that. And I think we've achieved it really well. And
absolutely,
the paint range
is,
you know, it keeps evolving and it keeps getting better. And so, and it's nice to have all those colours available as well. So, and that was a really nice sort of thing to do just before I left as well. So, and then I left, and then they named all the paints, and I still don't think I know all the names of all the paints, because to me they were codes. So it was like L013, and I'm like, oh, you mean that one? And I was like, yeah. So it was a bit different, but that was really fun. And yeah, I've got way too much paint. I need to get rid of some. No, I don't. I need to keep them all.
Do you have favourite colours to paint? Is there anything in particular? Do you enjoy painting more than others?
Yeah, I like painting red, I suppose.
Yeah.
Any shades of red is nice, fun.
The new paints definitely made painting, as someone who paints Blood Angels and Corn miniatures, the new paints made stuff an awful lot easier.
Mephiston red is red. Is the greatest invention ever made.
Yep.
For some reason, I don't really like painting gold.
Okay.
Metallic gold.
Yeah.
It seems to, I think, you know, we've got Retributor, Armor, and Liberator, which has made it so much easier. But when I say I don't like painting gold, I think it's old shining gold, because you'd have to go through the browns and layer it up.
Yeah,
and
now make some snakebite leather in there.
Yeah, you'd have to like go all the way around the houses just to get a good gold, but now it's fine because we've got some nice strong golds, but that's easier. But yeah, I think painting red is nice. I like doing that. I like painting different skin tones as well. That's always a good experiment. I always find when I painting, if I ever think, oh, I'm not that great at painting this colour, I'll practice that for quite a while. So I think for a long time I really didn't know how to achieve a good yellow. Mm-hmm. So I just spent a long time practicing yellow, and then there was painting faces. I always struggled with it, so I just spent a long time doing that. So I found that that was a good way of nailing down certain aspects of your painting. So for neatness, I found to start with, I struggled with getting a neat line and things like that as well. Mm. So I just painted Space Marines. People would say, how do you paint so neat? Just paint Space Marines for a long, long time, because you can't be messy with Space Marines. You've got to
crisp edge highlights.
Yeah. And then your muscle memory, you'll train your hand, your eye coordination. Mm. Paul Norton, who's just joined the Ever Metal team as well recently, he can paint Space Marines so sharp. Yeah. I mean, they're just razor. But that's because he just did a lot of Space Marines, and now, you know, with that accuracy, you can paint anything once you've got that accuracy, really. So, yeah.
That's a good tip. So, if you want to practice your fine line painting, Space Marines would be a good thing.
Yeah, I think, or anything with a sharp tower would be a good one as well, you know. So, just keep practice. Is that word, you know, practice... It's a lot of people want to know how to get better at painting, but that's really the secret.
Just lots of practice. Yeah, that's usually the answer to how do you become proficient at something. You do it a lot and you learn from those experiences.
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool. So we've talked a bit about painting, your background in painting. We should probably talk about some of the Warhammer 40,000 miniatures that you've been responsible for. Do you remember what the first plastic kit that you worked on for 40K was?
Yeah, that was the Sterngard Veterans for the Space Marines. So I had to basically take the metal Sterngard kit, the miniatures that Juan Diaz had sculpted, and turn them into a plastic set for the Space Marine range. What I really wanted to do with that was make sure that everybody got everything that they could get with the Sterngards, because I had a look at what you could take for the Sterngard if you had Sterngard in your army. Mm-hmm. And there's combi weapons, power fists and pistols and everything, basically. And I was like, okay, it's going to be a challenge to get everything in this on the frame, you know. Mm-hmm. And then get the five models as well. So I wanted the customers to be able to make as much as they could out of the set. And then anything you didn't make, you just ended up with loads of cool stuff to spread across your Space Marine army.
Yep.
So that was what I wanted to achieve. And I think I had, like, part count wise was a bit of a record for the amount of stuff I got on the frame as well. So it was really nice. And that was, they were made physically as well. So all of the sculpting now is done digitally on the computer. Back then we had to carve and sculpt and, you know, scrape and saw and do all of that stuff to make these miniatures. They were made at 3-up size, so, and I've still got them on my desk now as a reminder of the old days,
where we've come from.
That's it. So, and how hard it used to be making those miniatures, and, you know, on your hands as well. Yeah. So, but yeah, that was a really great experience.
And for anyone who doesn't know, the idea of the 3-ups, the parts of the models being made 3 times larger than they'd actually end up, my understanding of that was always that is the size at which the human eye can determine whether or not bits of model would get caught in the molds when the plastic injection molding machine separated.
That's right, yeah. So that they would actually get cast correctly for plastic. So it was basically that. So that you made sure there was no undercuts. Mm-hmm. So that the miniatures, when they were in steel, you know, the steel mold, that they wouldn't catch, basically. So
we've got computers for that now.
Yeah,
software programs that'll do all that.
Yeah, I've still got to do it. Mm-hmm. So it's part of the job we all don't love as much as the sculpting part, but it's a challenging part of the job. And and we used to do it all by hand, but now we do it on computer. That was a really fun kit to make, and still remember sculpting all those different heads that you get in there. Mm-hmm. As well. So in each one, I wanted to have a different character. So it did. The one I think I fondly remember is the guy with the beard, who was like the older veteran. And I still see him, people use him on their Space Marines now. And
it's distinctive. Yeah.
It's nice though to see that sort of stuff. And then there's the younger veteran and the old veteran. And one of the veterans is based off Titus from Space Marine, the computer game.
Awesome.
Yeah, because I had the Art of Space Marine book, and Cole Kapinski did some of the concept work. And I was like, they're just, the faces, they just looked like how a Space Marine should look. I was like, well, I'm going to do make sure one of those is on there as well. I think a lot of people spotted that when it came out as well, that one of them resembled Titus a little bit. And yeah, that was cool as well. So
I'm a big fan of that Stern Guard Veterans box for the amount of stuff that you get above and beyond what you need to build the squad. And I think I've said to you before, I've put the special issue ammunition and webbing onto intercessors to make Death Watch intercessors, and probably use some of those heads as well, because that'll be little personalities in a Death Watch kill team, and want them to set them apart from the other guys in the squad.
That's great. Mike Fors made the Vanguard Veterans at the same time, so we worked together to make sure that the details and the pacing of detail across the miniatures as well was correct, and what you didn't get in my kit, you got in his kit, and they worked well. The Space Marine range is great because it services everything.
Yeah.
So, like the Devastators, you can take the heavy weapons out and put the tactical squads,
etc. Think this stuff through.
Yeah. All that sort of stuff. So, we put a bit of thought in sometimes. Yeah. That was the first set I made. And then after that, I made the Sanguinary Priest for the Blood Angels. Mm-hmm. So I made that physically as well, but then finished it off on the computer.
Right.
So it was my first digital work, and then started working more digitally after that, and then worked on the Wolfen after that, which was really cool.
And the Wolfen, it's probably the start of your association with the Space Wolves miniatures that we've seen quite recently, and your personal hobby. You've always had a bit of an affinity for the Space Wolves. They've always come through.
Yeah, absolutely. If there's any Space Wolves to be made, people tend to have to fight me first to get them. So I like to make, if I get the opportunity to make a Space Wolf character or a Space Wolf set, I'll always put my hand up first and say, I'd really like to do this. Mm-hmm. And I've been lucky to be able to make a lot of them. I think my love for the Space Wolves came from when I first saw an issue of White Dwarf with, there was a fantastic Space Wolf army in there that Kim Seiberg had painted. He was an heavy metal painter from years back. And I just remember seeing that in White Dwarf number 183. I still remember it, and I've still got it on my shelf next to my desk and still look at it every now and then. And beautifully painted army, and I just knew that I wanted some Space Marines and I wanted some Space Wolves that just looked just like that, which I wanted to paint like that as well. So and I don't know why, I just really wanted them. I think it was the mix of Viking and Space Wolf barbaric things that they had going on. They were just really cool, and the colours as well, they just
it was a beautiful army, that one.
Yeah,
the highlights, the really soft transitions and the highlights.
Yeah, and he was the figure painter at the same time as Mike McVeigh. He was one of my hobby heroes as well. I think a lot of people remember Mike and learned a lot of my painting from him as well. I'll talk a bit more about that later.
I remember the Wolfguard Ranulf in that Kim Seiberg article.
Yeah.
The mighty Zug head, to give you a sense of the proportions. Absolutely. Of him. That was
and
gorgeous.
The way he added trophies onto his Predator as he'd gone through the battles and things. And such a great army.
Yeah, it was inspiring.
Really, really. And I tried to paint my Space Wolf army just like that. And it didn't ever look as good, but it was something that I aspired to. So yeah, I think that just sparked it all off then. And then ever since then, I think I've painted Ragnar Blackmane about 5 times over the years. So yeah, I just never tire of them. So sculpted the Wolfen, and then Crom Dragon Gaze was my first character for them, and then Gygor Fellhand. And that was really he was quite different because he was a 30k miniature
from the Burning of Prospero box.
Made him a little bit more rustic and his armor a little bit more ornate, sort of fit in with the time. And then Ulrich the Slayer, and that was quite a challenge. The original model being made by Jez Goodwin, so you know who he is, so I felt the need to speak to him first. So I'm going to remake his miniature. Told him that I wanted to reveal Ulrich's face but still keep the helm and have him in a very dwarf-like pose, which really suited him. Now Ulrich in the background is always surveying the battlefield, picking the next recruits,
the next big thing.
So that's what he's doing. And you can imagine the winds of Fenris blowing across his cloak. So whilst it's a static miniature, it's dynamic with those elements that the cloak's blowing across. That's where I pictured him and his face as well. I knew that I wanted that grizzled sort of weather-beaten look with the eye patch. It just added so much once they put that on. I was like, yeah, that just looks really cool. And he doesn't look too happy either, so he's probably seen some stuff. And then Haldor Icepelt was the last one I did. So a Primaris Space Wolf. So that was really cool as well. So just re-establishing where Space Wolf sit with the detail that was added onto him. So I didn't want to, because I know he was not Wolfguard level, sort of sitting Wolfguard level, so I didn't want to go adding everything on, because we need places to go in the future.
Absolutely,
so So that was cool. So yeah, Haldor was the last one.
Okay. I guess we'll see if there's anything else in the future as and when.
Fingers crossed, yeah, I'll be there first.
And you worked on the miniatures in the Kill Team Rogue Trader box as well, some of those. Did you work on them?
Yeah, most of the set was given to me as a project just to work on. It wasn't a completely solo project, so I made most of the Elusive Starstriders and the Gallipox. And then we had Joe, Christian and Maxime, who had just joined the team as trainees at that time.
Right.
None of them are trainees anymore. It's called Amazing Miniatures. And their first job was to make a Voidsman each, one of the three Voidsmen, and then all the little Gallipox creatures. So that's what they did. That was their first thing. They worked with me on that. And then I made the big monsters and the rest of the characters. And yeah, I think that took just over half a year of our work time to get that whole set done, and it was great to see it all released recently and received really well. And
blew people's minds, I think. Yeah,
it was fun. It was nice, and now I'm seeing people paint them and seeing the pictures online, and that's really rewarding when you see your miniatures like being painted and people have got them in their hands. The process of getting a miniature made on screen to plastic is a long time, and you know, by the time it comes out, you know, it's not old news to you, but you're working on things right now, which are on your screen. So people have got those now. You know, sometimes they come out a bit quicker, sometimes they come out a bit longer. And it's nice to see the Rogue Trader miniatures being used and being painted. It's really cool. And I really fondly remember that project. Worked with John Blanche. He provided so many great concepts on that. The monsters in particular, like, we had a whole folder of them, and I remember losing sleep because of how John's mind just, like, and he just, you know, put it on the page, and I was like, okay, I've got to make some miniatures out of this. Like, the heroes were, I called them the heroes, the Rogue Trader heroes. They were all great, and you know, a lot of them you'll see the concept art, and the miniatures relate to them quite a lot, and some of them I've had to take it a step further here and there. And that's the idea with miniature design, is the concept art team. They're just to spark you off to get you going. So there's still a lot of creativity that you've got to do yourself, because it's got to be miniatures as well, and there's a lot of that you've got to take into account. But yeah, John was great, and he did some crazy stuff. And then some of the monsters were exactly the same as what he drew, and then some I just took some parts of that one, some parts of this one, put them together. And they were really fun to do because they're all bloated and fat, but still got different elements of anatomy on them, like the guy with the fly on his arm, he's kind of a bit more of a hulking, restless physique. He's still got like a packed body, still quite muscular. Whereas the guy with the squid on his arm, he's more like flabby, fat, you know, pretty gross.
Doesn't look in a good way.
Yeah, but they're still quite big. So it was fun exploring different types of anatomy for that project as well. So yeah, that was a great project to work on.
Have you seen any kit bashes or conversions with anything that you've designed that you just weren't expecting, or you took you by surprise?
I think because I worked on the Adeptus Mechanicus range with Jez, and then worked on the Gene Stealer Cult range after that, I consciously made it so that those miniatures could be interchanged because they're human size. Yep. Much in the Space Marine range, you want to take the arms and swap them over in the head, so I made it so that some of that wasn't too much of a hard task for hobbyists, because I would want to do it and I want it to be easy. So I kept an eye on that. So I've seen a lot of people kit bashing Necromunda miniatures, Chaos Cultists, Adeptus Mechanicus, and all of those miniatures together, and the Gene Stealer Cults, all just to make unique miniatures. And the easier we can keep, if we can keep that in our minds more as well, it makes it easier for hobbyists just to have fun with those kits. So
the idea of a Gene Stealer Cult infesting a Forge world somewhere. We've definitely seen people kitbashing bits of Skitarii, bits of Neophyte hybrids.
Absolutely. I mean, there's the Bladed Cog, I think, there. So I think that's where it was sort of born from, was like, you know, these go with these. And then I think it's just, then people go, oh, that's really cool. And then your imagination takes over. And then you just have to get your clippers out and get your plastic.
Yeah, absolutely.
And have a go at it. So, yeah, it's really nice to see people do some crazy conversions. I've seen some really great ones of Alucia Vane recently, where people have taken Alucia Vane's torso and I forgot her name, the female Eldar character that Neil Langland
saw. Oh, Yvraine.
Yeah, Yvraine. And put her bust on her legs. And it's like, she looks so cool. I should have done that. But and there's loads of cool stuff. But yeah, it's great. Just, you can see, because we get, it's so easy to see everybody's hobby now. Mm. Like people are posting pictures on Instagram, Facebook, you know, Twitter, and you can just get instant sort of awesome, cool hobby straight away rather than having to wait. Like when we did, when we were young, to wait
posting to White Dwarf.
Yeah. Wait for White Dwarf, yeah. And that was it. So, but now it's really great. Everybody's spoiled, which is not fair.
No, it's inspiring, isn't it? But it's sometimes difficult to maintain focus because I'm painting this until I see something on Twitter. Well, I could just put one of those together. I've got the bits to put one of them together, and then you're down the rabbit hole.
Yeah, I almost went down the Tyranid rabbit hole the other day, and really? I was like, I'm gonna wait. I've got some other stuff to do.
It's a logical progression from your Gene Stealer cults, though, right? Yeah. It'd be easy enough.
It's nearly Christmas. Maybe I should ask for the Tyranid now. I've got other stuff to do. Yeah. Being strict with yourself, but it's inspiring to see other people's stuff.
I guess you learned that discipline when you talked about your childhood, concentrating on single miniatures, getting the most out of them.
Yeah, but I can have more of them now, so it's harder to say no to myself. So it's like, okay, I've just got it. So I'm working on my Eldar.
Yep.
And I've got my Space Marines, mm-hmm. and I play a lot of Blood Bowl as well with you guys. So that's also fun. So keeping your focus is difficult, especially when you're surrounded by like all the cool miniatures in the studio.
Absolutely.
And you see the stuff that's coming up as well.
Yep.
That's a real challenge.
So you think if I just started this project in 3 or 4 years' time, I'd be ready for when all of this other stuff
I get a head start on everybody. Yeah. No. But I get really excited about it when the customers get it. Mm. So look, and that's really great. You get that whole sort of buzz, which is really nice. So that's a really good part of it all.
Cool. I guess Space Marines and the Elucidian Star Striders and the Gellipox Infected are at different ends of spectrums, really, for miniatures. The Space Marines range is huge. It's got probably loads more growth to come, lots of interchangeability. And then the Elucidian Star Striders, the Gellipox Infected, are very much those things.
Yeah.
They're not meant to be anything else. Do you think there are any qualities of what makes a Warhammer 40,000 Citadel miniature, even with those sorts of extremes? Is there anything common to everything that you've worked on, or many of the things that you've worked on?
Yeah, one thing that I'm always conscious of is making miniatures. I always say, it's the one line I always say, so the ultimate destiny of our miniatures is to be painted and then played with. Mm-hmm. They've got to be painted first, so making sure that those miniatures can be painted and in the least amount of trauma possible is always nice. So just making sure those miniatures are paintable and they take paint well, and the details on there popping out as they should be. It's always frustrating when you're painting a miniature, you can't get into a place, or you don't know what something is, or it bleeds into another area. You know, had stuff like really old miniatures used to, you know, sometimes frustrate me a bit. So I'm always conscious of making it. So if it's your first miniature you were going to paint, I'd always try and make it a pleasurable experience. So the detail was a good level, and it looked like it was supposed to look like, and you know, it read as the surface that it was supposed to be as well. So yeah, I'm always conscious of that. Recently I'm trying to focus more on composition of miniatures. Seb Perbe is our one of our senior designers, so I always ask for his feedback and his sort of direction on composition, because that's what he's so great at, and the miniatures he makes, from the angles, the viewing angle, it's just perfect. So I'm always more conscious of that now. So I'm trying to evolve my design more that way, as well as making the details important. Mm. They're really the last thing that should be going on. So it's all about the pose and the composition, and is the miniature reading really well from the tabletop, because that's where they sit, you know, those kind of things. So yeah, and making miniatures dynamic as well. I mentioned about Ulrich earlier. Mm. He's standing still, but he still feels dynamic. You know, still his cloak's blowing around. He's got a dynamic presence. So there's those kind of things as well. So you don't want a boring miniature, even if it's got to stand still. There's other ways you can play with it to make it exciting.
The Ulrich miniature always makes me imagine there's a lot of activity going on around him.
Yeah.
He might be the calm in the eye of the storm, or all the impetuous blood claws, or the Fenrisian wolves are yipping around, and he's
waiting.
An eye on
for, yeah, he's waiting for his moment, and that's it. Yeah. He doesn't need to do anything; just a look. Yeah, so they're the elements that I'm really concentrating on, like, all of the time, really. Mm. So,
do you work from sketches at all, or is it just what's in your head and then trying to realise that on the screen?
So it depends on the project. Like, so we've got a great concept team, mm-hmm. and John's part of that as well. So sometimes we'll be given some concepts, and we'll get asked to concept and then mock those miniatures up, so see what they might look like. Daz, have a go. So I'm like, okay, cool. So I get to have a play, and then I put a bit of myself in there as well, because like I said, it's just to spark off. And then sometimes you'll get asked just to make some miniatures. you know, we've got this in mind, see what you come up with. So, and that really does depend. We've got a great concept team, so luckily we can bounce ideas back and forth with them. And then as we're working, we'll often be doing sketches as well. So if a guy's got a sword, design the sword, draw it out, or the gun, different elements. That's kind of my approach, is to draw different elements of the miniature rather than the whole thing. And once the composition's done, you can add those in as well. So, sure. But every designer works differently. So, but then, you know, we've all got our mentors as well. So I got a little group of the designers I'll always go and talk to. It's like Jez and Seb. And then depending on what project it is, I'll go and talk to different designers. So some of them are, you know, experts in, like Matt Holland, he knows everything about Tau and orcs. Yep. So if I've got to make an orc, I'll definitely go and see him. Neil Langdown is elves, Eldar. Go and speak to him, for example. So
different pockets of the studio have got different areas of expertise.
And different strengths as well. Like Dale Stringer and Tom Walton, they make the amazing vehicles, really. Like, they do a lot of the vehicles, dreadnoughts, knights, all of that stuff.
And stuff that looks like it actually works.
And it does, and it's great, and those guys do an amazing job. So, and they also make miniatures as well, but their strength is that. So why not just keep doing that, because it's really good and it's working really well. So,
do you have a favourite miniature? Would you be allowed to say a favourite miniature that either you've worked on or that you haven't worked on? Is there anything that stands out?
Yeah, I've done the Hall of Fame for White Dwarf a few times, so I've put Ragnar in there and Deathmaster Snitch in the past. I think recently I said Archaon for composition, because it's something that I'm personally trying to focus on, because I'm always trying to get better, as you should. Another one of my favourite miniatures was the Terminator Captain with the Power Fist, which is a classic one. I think I've painted many of those over the years. My favourite miniature is one that's not released yet.
That's a good answer.
So I can't talk about it.
That's fine. That's very diplomatic. We don't have to tread on anyone's toes.
And I'll come back on and talk about it when it's released. So, it is amazing. So
I'll hold you to that. You'll just have to tell me after we go off air.
No, I will, and I'm dead excited about it as well.
So we've talked a bit about your background in painting and in sculpting miniatures and the miniatures you like. As someone who's had 10 years of experience as a Golden Demon judge and being in the heavy metal team, do you have any good advice for anyone looking to either be a competitive or professional painter or just be a better painter?
Yeah, I get asked that quite a lot. So we mentioned about practice earlier. And it's not simply just practicing. So I remember when I was learning to paint, I didn't have a lot of people around me that I could get feedback from. So it was just learning and then retrying and then learning again. So people can surround themselves now by people that are better than them, or people they can learn off, whether that be in your Games Workshop store, in your local hobby group, or online. It's so accessible now just to see other awesome stuff that you see. And then ask for feedback on your work, and then take that feedback in. Don't be offended by it. Learn from it, and then go back and do more painting. So when I was learning to paint, I would get up before school, paint, go to school, come home, obviously do your homework. It's important. And then do more painting. So it was just putting those hours in, perseverance. If you want to become a better painter, you've got to keep painting. You've got to listen to feedback. And you if you're the best painter in the room, you're in the wrong room. Get surrounded by better painters, and you'll keep pushing yourself, which is why the heavy metal team do so well, because they keep pushing themselves, and they're always stepping up that ladder. So keep practicing. Make sure you've got the right tools as well, the best brushes you can find. Look after your equipment. They're the main bits of feedback, I would say. Just you've got to keep practicing and speaking to people and asking for feedback.
A friend of mine was at one of the recent Heavy Metal Masterclass events in Warhammer World, and he spoke very highly of it. He came away with a load of enthusiasm for painting. He was painting all weekend, but he was still up for painting more when he got back, which I guess is the right kind of outcome. That's what you want from people who want to paint more and better. Yeah. Paint more.
And nowadays, it's so much easier to... It's easy to get that information, because putting paint on a miniature is one thing, and putting the paint in the right place is another thing. But knowing the techniques and the methods is something that you can learn over time yourself, but you can learn it in 5 minutes off somebody else, because they'll tell you how to do it. And be going to masterclasses or reading tutorials or just speak to people, it's so much easier. And you can get, and then remember the first time when I worked in the store and I showed someone how to dry brush, and then that look on their face, I was like, oh, that's it. And you get that, and like, I mean, you get that hit, you know, yeah. you know what it is. So just keep communicating with people, I think, is the main thing. Go to Golden Demons as well. Mm-hmm. And have a look at things that inspire you, and yeah, is the main thing. Just keep looking at images of awesome miniatures, and it will make you a better painter over time, as long as you're putting the hours in and you're practicing.
And how about designing miniatures? Because I guess when we were younger and smaller, we could have mashed up some green stuff and tried making something over an armature. It seems like the business is a little bit different now. You might need, how would you suggest someone gets into designing miniatures if that's what's interesting?
Yeah, so if you want to make miniatures, I still think that sculpting with green stuff or putty is a really great way of doing it. And I think it's something that when we're looking for new miniature designers, we get people send in their physical greens and their sculpting as well. So it still shows that you know how to make miniatures, and therefore you will be able to do it digitally as well, mm-hmm. you know, with the right training. So I would still say get some green stuff and make if you've not got access to a computer or you fancy doing that, yeah, have a go at that. But if you do, you know, you've got some cool programs and you know how to sculpt, then just use that as well. But I'd still recommend just converting some models. The first thing I ever got told to do was copy a model.
Yep.
So I copied Brian Nelson's Freelance Knight with the sword and the moustache.
The Mordheim fella.
I was like, so I copied that, and I literally just sat there for 2 weeks and sculpted that, and then took it into the studio manager and said, look. And he was like, do you want to have a little go? So that was when I started with design. It was copied a couple of miniatures, and then they trusted me to do some proper sculpting then afterwards. So yeah, I'd say just copy your miniature that you love, so it'll give you a really great experience. So.
That's great. And did you refine it in any way? Did you add any of your own sort of touches or flourishes to the freelance
Brian's
that you
miniature?
Made?
Yeah. That's impossible. He's a sculpting god. So he's obviously still sculpting now. I'm not often trying to get some advice out of him for what I'm working on as well. So both him and Jez and Seb, they're your go-to guys.
It's a pretty powerful group of people to take guidance from.
I got some really great advice off Brian recently as I was doing some work, and I said, I don't know where to go with this particular thing, and he just said, challenge everything. And I was like, and he just hit a note with what I was working on at the time. I was like, just, you know, push it, work on it more. And he's not a man of many words. When Brian says something, you know it's going to be something useful. So, you know, that was my thing. It was just like, say to people about painting, surround yourself by better people. So I'd always go to the designers that I'm working with. All of the designers are great. The ones that I'll go and see, depending on what projects I'm working on, I'll go and see them and then get great advice from them as well. So.
Cool. And what features of the 41st millennium, what about Warhammer 40,000, do you like the most, and do you like exploring in the miniatures that you're working on?
Yeah, I think the whole 40k universe is just something that it's just so vast, and yeah, obviously it's the universe is big, and you can just imagine we explore Imperial Guard, and there's billions of soldiers on planets everywhere, and they're all different types, and then we explore the Gene Stealer Cult, which is just a tiny little thing, so it's as big or as small as you want it to be. Like the Tyranids, they've got high fleets that, you know, whole galaxies wide, and I just love how free it is, and that there could be anything in it. So I think that, and I like sci-fi as well anyway, so I'm really sort of warm towards that. So I mean, most of the miniatures I've made have been Warhammer 40,000 miniatures. I think that's just through circumstance really, but working on the Adeptus Mechanicus range with Jess, that was great, and then the Gene Stealer Cult after that, that was really fun as well, just playing with that, taking something old like the Gene Stealer Cult, and then mixing a little bit of nostalgia in with the new, which I think, you know, people seem to warm to a lot, and I really enjoyed that as well. So putting some retro sci-fi in there and the old miniatures, and mixed it all in and made some new miniatures, and that was awesome. So remaking old classics.
It's a great time at the moment where people of a similar sort of age to ourselves, I guess, are getting the opportunity to revisit what inspired us as younger hobbyists when it first came around in the 80s or the 90s, and seeing a lot of those ideas represented much, much nicer with more options and more new things, brand new things that didn't really exist in the original ideas from 20 years or so ago.
And then putting those miniatures into to a better material as well. So yep. We've got plastic, and everybody knows that the Sisters of Battle are being worked on and they're coming up. So, and I get to be around that,
yep.
And I get to see it, and I'm like, this is awesome.
Have you been working on that project at all?
I can't really say too much.
Okay. Maybe in the future we can talk more.
One miniature that I have worked on that people have seen is the first Sister of Battle, which was shown last year at Warhammer Fest,
yep.
Which is the miniature which was based off Karl Kapinski's artwork. Mm-hmm. So that was what I have worked on.
Fantastic.
Anything else? Can't say yet.
Nope. So. We'll maybe talk more about it in the future. We'll see more of that range, because that'll be very exciting.
What's to come? It's amazing. Everything that's coming up is amazing. So it's really exciting.
And what are you working on in your personal hobby at the moment?
So I'm just working on my Eldar army a little bit. So I really like playing games as well, and playing the new 40K is good. So I used to just paint display miniatures if I ever painted, but now I'm really getting into playing games more. But I always wanted an Eldar army that was painted to the best ability that I could, and it just takes so long. So I'm trying to get through that. And in the background, I've got my Space Marine army, which I'm working on, my Silver Skulls as well. So, and I've trained myself to paint those to not paint them worse, but to use methods that allow me to get through them quicker. So spraying them and then using washes, but making sure they're still neat, something that I'm proud of as an army. And I got to play a battle report with them in White Dwarf not long ago. So,
that's cool. Hobby goal.
Yeah, it was. I messaged Matt Keith, who was the editor at the time, and said, like, I really want to do a battle report. I've never done one. It's on my bucket list. And he was like, great, cool, we'll have you on. So we did that. I played with James Karch. It was my Marines and his Marines versus some Tau, Dan Harden and Matt Hollins. And that was really fun experience. It's hard work as well. Yeah. It was a whole day, you know. But it was really good. And I hope to do it again in the future, to be honest. But then I play a lot of 40K when I can. Sadly, my Eldar army is not fully painted, so shame on me. I'm working on it.
It does look amazing, so I think people will be happy to wait and see more of those models painted.
I finished my Guardians, and there's 10 Guardians. They don't really stay on the battlefield long enough for people to enjoy them, so I normally end up putting them in the case. But yeah, I just want an Ulthway army, and I want to get that done. So I don't care how long it takes, so I'm just going to keep carrying on with that. And then I'm hoping to do some Age of Sigmar soon.
Okay.
Just start venturing into that. But I play a lot of Blood Bowl as well. And what's nice with Blood Bowl for me is, because that's worked on in the other studio with the Forgewood guys, I like to experience that at the same time as the customers.
Yeah.
So I get the new team. Oh, it's a new team. And, you know, all of that sort of stuff. So I play a lot of Blood Bowl in the Nottingham League with the guys in Warhammer World, in Bugman's. So we play in Bugman's. So it's a hard life, you know. We get to finish work and go and play Blood Bowl in Bugman's and have a pint and have a laugh. And I love
twist the arm. Go on.
I know, yeah. It's great. So we play on Wednesdays, and the guys are all really great, like Steve and Johnny and Hugh that runs the league. And that's a really good laugh. And Blood Bowl was a game that I've always played since I was a kid. You just keeps dragging you back in.
Yeah.
It's a cruel game as well. that's what I mainly work on. So I'm going to be working on the new Blood Bowl team soon as well. Mm-hmm. So, 'cause most of my old teams are the old metal ones. So.
I saw a few of your posts over the summer about your kill team, the Gene Steeler cult kill team that you were working on. And I got the sense I'd seen a few people asking for your recipes on how to paint Gene Steeler flesh. It seemed like you'd been converted to the ways of painting over a white undercoat using maybe different techniques to how you might have done it in the past. Was this new information or new styles coming into the design studio?
Yeah, so the design studio, we've got lots of the designers, and then there's lots of those designers that are hobbyists. Mm-hmm. We've got Maxime Passerelle, Maxime Courbet as well. There's some of the new French designers. Well, they knew, they've been there for years, but they're French designers, and they use new methods to paint their models, which I'd never seen before. So it's like, keep an open mind, give it a go. Maxime sprays his models white and uses washes and glazes. And I was like, okay, I'll give that a go. And I was like, oh, this is quite quick. So I've been trying that out as well, which is why I was thinking, maybe I should do a Tyranid army. And I was like, no, I've got other stuff to do. But yeah, so just get trying different techniques and learning from those guys as well is fun. So anything that gets my stuff done quicker so I can play some games. But yeah, I finished the kill team as well. So I need to play some more games with those guys. Yeah, that was fun to do. So.
Great stuff. Not been trying out for the old way, though. Not been doing black over a white undercoat.
No, that didn't work quite as well. But that was fun because painted the Gene Steeler cults, those are the models that I designed as well. So that's a really great learning experience. Putting paint on them, like, I should have done this bit a little bit. I'll remember that for next time, you know.
Okay. Did you have any learnings for future miniature sculpting.
Yeah, and I did the same thing with the Adeptus Mechanicus Guitari. So I you know, worked on those with Jez and then took any learnings from there. So there's always something you can learn from stuff. So, just to make it better for, you know, the customers to get better miniatures, really. So.
And you've got a Blogspot site where you've got tips on armies and pictures and stuff that people can...
So I had a blog for many years. Yeah. So when I'm painting stuff, it's always nice just to put stuff out there and get some feedback. And one of the things that I always like to do is if I can help other people, I will do. Mm-hmm. And Mike McVeigh never, you know, sort of held me to ransom, like, you know, for information or anything. He was always really happy to share it, and so did all the other Emerald painters. So it's nice to pass on knowledge if I can, whilst I'm always trying to gain knowledge as well from other people, like from the new painting techniques. So I post, when I put my miniatures on my blog, which is Razor Mini Painting, I put the recipes on there as well. Yeah. And then also, same with Instagram, I'll put my pictures up on there as well, just for fun, and put the tutorials and on Twitter as well. You're on Twitter too?
I'm on the Twitter, yeah, I'm on the Twitter.
So it's just fun. And then there's a good group of guys on each, you know, platform. And I got the blog really because I just wanted somewhere where I could have all of my stuff.
Yeah.
And it's nice to have and just keep updating as well. So that's fun. So.
Is it mostly Space Wolves?
No, there's a bit of everything, yeah. Try and do everything, really. So there are some many Space Wolves on there.
But like you're talking about the faces, doing practices of faces, I seem to remember quite a few Darren Latham painted human faces of various complexions over the years, and White Dwarf and painting
guides. Yeah, we did lots of masterclasses for White Dwarf when I was in the Heavy Metal team. And that was something that I really enjoyed doing. It's something that we planned a lot. And they actually made it into a masterclass compilation book at the end, which is like a rare thing that's hard to get hold of these days. And I've got my copy next to my desk as well, and still have a look through it. And I think one of the things which I'm most proud of from my painting time was the masterclasses that we worked on in Heavy Metal, because they helped so many people.
Yeah.
And I still have people talk to me about them now. So they seem to have resonated quite a lot. And in particular, the Sanguinor masterclass, which people still talk to me about. Mm. And I think it was the first time that we showed non-metallic metal in a stage by stage. Because it was always the, how do you do it? Oh, it's a mystical thing.
This is from French Golden Demon. Yeah. We don't know any more than this than you do.
So we broke it down and we showed how it was done in the, it was in White Dwarf and then it was in the book afterwards as well. And people still talk about it. Trying to get hold of that magazine still. Yeah. So, and it's really nice to see that. And I think what's really great is that people took a lot, I've seen a lot of painters take that and make it better. And that's really nice to see. And there's loads of great Golden Demon painters out there now, too many to list, that have taken that technique and made it better. Gareth Nicholas has just joined the Citadel design team, and he's a Golden Demon winner. He won Golden Demon on Saturday, in fact. And he's a fantastic non-metallic metal painter as well. And it's nice when he talks as well, because he said, oh, it's just the way you do it. It's just like, well, you're doing it better now. So, and that's really great. So it's passing on that knowledge, sharing knowledge. I think if people can be encouraged to do that more, then that's really great, because everybody gains then. That's really good. So
the masterclass features always felt like, even if they weren't directly beneficial to me, certainly at that point in time, I could always feel that maybe if I got a bit better, I could come back to this, and there's always something more in the hobby to aspire to, or to learn, or to challenge yourself with.
Yeah.
Because there's an awful lot of, it's great to see all the Citadel paint stuff of, you can put a base paint on and shade it and go and play games with it. You absolutely can, and that's great. But some people want to feel like there's something else to aspire to or build up to, and having that level being presented is great to have that goal.
It's aspirational stuff. So, yeah. And it was nice to see, because I really enjoyed it when I used to see Mike McVeigh's mini tutorials he did, and I've still got the Heavy Metal painting guide that he did, which has got like four stages and a finished miniature, and I was like, really? Okay. But so then we tried to expand on it a little bit more. But it did the same thing. It showed you that this was achievable, and that's what those masterclasses did, and the guys still do them now. Simon did one for freehand recently from White Dwarf, and that was really great. Mm. I think he went into loads of techniques and stuff for that, and that was a really great masterclass. So I think the more people, if you can do that and you can share it and show people how it's done, then that's a great thing. So why not? So
is there anything you still struggle to paint, or anything that you still need a bit of perfecting? at the moment.
Apart from my armies.
Yeah, finished armies.
Actually, I'd really like to learn more techniques to paint things faster, which is why I've been doing. But then I often ask myself, should I be painting display miniatures? Should I just be doing that? And then I'm like, I had a conversation with someone recently and said, you enjoy playing games and paint your armies. It's fine, you know. Don't put pressure on yourself to do something. If you enjoy playing games, painting armies, and Golden Demon's not your thing, then do that. But if you want to win a Golden Demon, you must focus on that display painting. Mm. So people say, how do I win a Golden Demon? I say, are you painting armies? Are you playing lots of games? They say, yeah. I say, well, you need to do more yoga. And they go, but I really like playing games. I say, well, just do that then, if that's what makes you happy. So you can't. It's hard to have it both ways. And there's only a few painters that I've met that can do both. Maxime Pastorel is one. He paints amazing armies really fast and then wins Golden Demons, and I don't know how he does it. And it's not fair. And then there's some of the guys that do that as well. But yeah, it's hard to juggle both. But if you're learning to paint, then you really probably should just focus on one or the other. But either way, it's whatever you enjoy, just do that.
And if you've got youth on your side, you know, unlike us, but other people who are starting out.
We're still young.
We're young at heart, aren't we? Yeah. But there are younger people, I guess, who've maybe got a bit more time to practice or devote some time to single miniature painting and then come back to painting armies in the future.
It's crazy because you see people painting now and you say, oh, that's really good. How long have you been painting? 2 years. Like, yeah. It took me like 15 years to get to that level, and that's not fair. No. So, and it's obvious that people are learning and, you know, there's easier ways of getting that information. So, yeah. Yeah. It's good. Good for them.
Well, I think we've pretty much run out of time. I think we've talked about loads of stuff. We've talked about your past, your history, painting, sculpting, space wolves, and other challenges. Thank you very much for your time, Daz. I hope we can come get you back on the show and talk in the future, maybe when we can see what your favourite miniature that you've worked on is that the world doesn't know about yet, and maybe talk some more about painting.
That was my pleasure. Thanks. That was really good.
Cheers.